Moving on, our next speaker is Patrick Bros, Head of API Design and Data Governance at Emidis. He's here with us to present the talk on how APIs are becoming data-centric to be smart APIs. Welcome, Patrick.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, hello, everyone.
Yes. Can you hear us well?
Yes, and you?
Yep, good. Can you put up your slide as well? Let's check before we get on. Yeah, that's good. All right, so we have quite a lot of topics today around data, and I think this is this topic is going to be interesting too, creating smart APIs using data. So over to you, Patrick.
Thanks a lot, and I appreciate to be with you. I will start to speak about how data could be more and more data-centric. So the foundation of the API is data-centric for sure, but let's see how it could be smart. But first, we should perhaps provide a definition together what is smart. So properties by properties, I will give you an illustration about a real life an API designer providing smart APIs. So let's take inspiration about what we call a flip phone. So flip phone perhaps not be considered as very smart. No storage, only perhaps your phone number directory, simple to use, or only a simple numeric keyboard. So let's try to understand text. Autonomous. A little bit, yes, you can send, receive messages, but that's it. Connected, yes, you are connected to your cellular network, but nothing about sensor to capture your health, to capture your blood oxygenation or health. Interactive application, not really. You have just perhaps a calendar, a calculator, and so on. Interactive application, not really, and send notification. Directly to have a kind of automation between applications. To be honest, that kind of flip phone cannot be considered as smart. But of course, you know what is smart, basically, because in fact, if you continue to take inspiration about the smart device, so what is a smart device? Basically, is something which is data-centric. So you have your smartphone, your smartwatch, and then, step by step, we discover typically all the properties of something which is smart. So, of course, it could be data-centric. Yes, it's the focus to have that kind of device nowadays is to capture data, to exchange data. So, this is for sure that device which are data-centric. No doubt about that. Simple to use. Yes, look about how many hours you are using that kind of device per day. If it's something like this is not smart, you will abandon. Autonomous, it's because in fact, basically, you can it's standalone entity. You can use your GPS. You can use other sensor and so on. So there is lots of new functionality and so on. So in terms of connection. Of course, you can connect, and you see now even smart devices are connected each other. So you have the interactive application. Of course, if each application can exchange data themselves together. And the most is, of course, you can interact directly with the user, and you have some automation to send you some alerts and so on. So now we know what is a smart device. So let's see what could be a smart API. So first of all, let me introduce myself. I'm head of API design data model governance inside Amadeus. And today I'm going to talk how we can build an API that could be smart. And now we have the definition, so we'll apply those principles. And I will help you to illustrate that with one of our challenge that we recently have to produce safe travel widget internally inside Amadeus, which is a product, and we'll see how we design APIs to be connected between the widget and Amadeus system. So the challenge, this challenge is really is applicable to all of us. Build an elegant and future-proof API in a minimum of time. So this is the concept that we have to put in place for our safe travel product, and we have to build internal APIs that should be elegant, of course, because when you say elegant, is systematically you add new features, new functionality, but it should stay simple to use. Otherwise, if you have to learn it systematically after each evolution, it's something that could be problematic for our consumer and even internal consumer. Future proof, we are working in safe, using safe methodology in agile model, sprint by sprint. So the question is how could be stable, and you have to stay stable during the time. If you break everything, every version, every new functionality, you will have some trouble. So we have to keep the stability and all those constraints in a minimum of time. So minimum of time is because we are working in urgent manner for the pandemic. So we have to deliver something in efficient manner. So this is the scope of our project, and Amadeus is really here here as a leading IT provider in the global travel industry to help via the technology to help our travel agent, our airlines, airports, hotels, and all players to distribute that prime product and their operation. So this challenge is something that we try to handle every day. So let's see how the Safe Travel API will be able to manipulate some data like health pass, health travel document, or travel conditions. So let's see. So we started to define a smart definition, a definition about smart. So let's see the road trip of our API designer. So smart device, as we see, is something that should be data-centric, having simple usage, to be autonomous, connected, interactive, and be able to send notification. So what about smart API? How to do the correlation? In fact, we'll start to think about data, and to be data-centric, we will be first resource-oriented. Then if you continue to apply those REST principles, those responsible impose you to have a state, and you will see the advantage to have a state and to manipulate this state. Around that, to have more autonomy, each resources will have some kind of controllers, and we'll see in detail the advantage of controllers and how it will help you to manipulate your resource or your data. Hypermedia is certainly the in terms of. Richardson maturity model, the level 3, the usage of hypermedia. At the beginning, when you start to design API, we don't think about that, you don't need that. But step by step, to improve, to have more conditions, more capability, at the end, you discover that that kind of hypermedia concept could be very useful. Webhook also is one of the most advanced concepts of OpenAPI, so we'll see how those webhook will help you to be interactive with your API consumer. And the most will be certainly to be event-driven with the async API concept. So now we will see step by step what is the meaning to be smart. So for a smartphone, you have to be data-centric. For an API, you have to be resource-oriented. And this is a little parallel that we can do with a programming language. Historically, people started to code in C or that kind of language where you have some procedural functions. Nothing bad about that. It was useful, no problem with that. And you can see that basically you have two major information in your procedural calls, the functionality and the data. But you see inside the name, the naming of your function or the parameters, it's difficult to understand where is the functionality, where is the data. And if you go and you reuse the principle of oriented object like C++ or Java, here you will discover that the oriented object design will help you to identify very quickly the data itself and their associated data associated functionality. And this principle of to moving from procedural to object-oriented is the first step, and it is the beginning of to be data-centric. So let's continue now about the state. So how something which is static, because when you access the data, you retrieve an image, you have just visibility of the last state. How can you visualize that potentially something can move? So basically, it's to be from static to dynamic. And in fact, you just need to apply one of the REST principle, representational state transfer, is to consider a state of something. Here, again, I will continue with the safe travel widget. So basically, it will be connected to a backend. And even you will see that we'll have a third actor here that will be a third party server. And this Evernight system allows us, you will see, to validate some else document or else path without storing them, we are not certified. So basically, we trust a certified company having this capability. But how to model the state on the fact that we'll verify some data? So basically, here we'll see a concept of status. And the status will evolve during the time. So first, your API, you will create the third-party verification. So basically, you create something and you recognize a post operation, which is a HTTP methods. And here you have the path of your objects that you want to target. So you create a third-party verification. This is a simple object having ID and status. And then when this third-party verification that we call internally, will start the verification and ask some intermediate things to the user. So basically here, we will not interact ourselves from the widget with the customer. So we'll have a third party asking something in background, like a 3D secure validation with your credit card, to upload the document or scan the QR code, and it's completely transparent for us. We have no visibility. But at the end, we have something coming back, we're telling us, okay, this verification is ongoing, and internally we receive a call telling us that it's okay. So, and this is in the reply, basically, we can update the resource saying now we are no more ongoing state, but we are verified state. So let's see, basically, this change of state is something very interesting to give a status of something which is dynamic. So you see, looking at the state, you can retrieve your verification process, and you know where you are, and you know that it is finished. So this is a simple way to use the concept of state. What about the next step? So basically, the controller. So you see, I start to model something which was a functionality via a resource called verification. And here is an advanced concept, which is very simple at the end, it's completely obvious, is not to consider the verb, you know, remember, with the procedural things, you consider the job itself. And you can consider that this job will be a kind of view of a microservice. So let's continue in detail to show what are the limitations. So today, HTTP method in REST will have some limitation like CRUD operation. You can create, read, update, delete, but in terms of we have some limitation saying that okay, I can just manipulate data which are resources. But the question is how to handle more complex processes. This example of verify a health pass. Here we invented a concept of controllers, and the controller will have a model, and the model will be basically the object of the controller. And this controller will have a status. So this is a kind of sub-resource which is attached to your resource. And basically, you can start to create a cartography with a lot of satellites around your resource to manipulate the resource. Similar to a microservice, basically, you have a limitation scope of this usage, and you know what you do, and you know what would be basically the behavior of things in a simple manner. So this is basically nothing new for you, just a simple REST concept that you have to implement. And step by step, we have more and more things to add in our self-travel product. So typically, you start to verify some document, and now let's see how your API could be just a set of endpoints to provide you some relationship between them, following the state of the art of W3C and the JSON schema standard. So let's continue to upload a document to be verified. And here in that case, we upload the document because we can verify them on ourselves, it's possible. And basically, we'll post a verification on some documents. So this is quite similar to what we see just before. But now we load several documents and we'll have a status. Okay, the status is still ongoing, but imagine that you have some missing document or documents that need to be reloaded. Here, the idea is just during the state of your verification job to give another information which are missing document. And here, the idea is really to provide details to the user how he can do, what could be the next step. And this is typically what is important and interesting with HOS and Hypermedia, is really to provide some next step attached to your object. So here you have href on another API, which is attach even a sub resource, which is the fact to attach some document to the verification process. And here, to this particular verification process, you can attach new document. And even the most advanced concept that you can use is the concept of hyperschema, where you can say, okay, what I'm waiting is just some document and a particular one related to COVID-19 test and having a specific validity duration. So here you have an example how basically between one resource you can be linked to a sub-resource or the resource. And not just a physical link between data and data, but in fact to document what could be the next step for the consumer. And here you start to have to be really connected between resources. The Hypermedia is something that you know, and one other advanced concept is the concept of webhook. Remember when I started to present you the third-party verification process, there was a status ongoing. I remember there was this little okay. So basically, you have a resource which is here, which has been created, you can visualize it. But in fact, basically, the state will change in asynchronous manner. And this is basically something that could happen when you need to receive information from the third party. It will update something in background and you have something which is asynchronous. The question is how to implement the concept of a resource that should be updated in asynchronous manner. In fact, you need to define a kind of webhook on your system that will be a kind of callback for the third system. So this time, this API will not be visible from the, let's say, from the original consumer. It will be a correlated API, which will be available for the third party. And basically, we can subscribe to this third party dynamically, and we can provide a new endpoint associated to our resource to help him to update our resource in asynchronous manner. So basically, we will declare a new endpoint, and this new endpoint will be used by this third-party provider, and we receive some Evernight event via this URL, and this URL has been registered as a webhook on their system dynamically. So basically, our resource third-party verification can evolve and can be updated by a dedicated endpoint which is related to our verification resource. So this is, let's say, the ultimate way to be connected, the fact to receive some asynchronous event. Now the question is, okay, remember about your smartphone or smartwatch, you are able to receive yourself some notification. So basically here it is the opposite. So now up to here we are able to receive some event. Now this is the idea is how to send events. And nice to that, we have the fact that now your resource will be no more passive but will be active, saying that potentially there is an algorithm or let's say a new state that should be documented somewhere else. So how we can do that? The idea is to provide some subscription to your API in order to send event itself. And this is the concept of event-driven, but apply to resource-oriented design of your API. So let's imagine that you have now still your Amadeus Safe Travel widget, and we have another backend or server called Duty of Care. So Duty of Care is another API that helps you to get some COVID area reports. So basically when you say area, it's because in fact the report of the status of the COVID-19 is depending on some country, some city, some region. And basically when you call this API, you will retrieve a lot of travel conditions like the exit conditions, the entry condition on the country. And basically it could be at country or city or region level. So imagine that you have this, we have this API, and the widget now would like to be informed that potentially there is some evolution around the specific area. So for example, you are traveling to a specific country and the rule of the travel condition are changing. The question is how to get notified that this resource will evolve. And basically, you can imagine to have another controller that helping you to monitor this resource. And this controller, basically, you can provide some detail about the country, about the situation of your travel. And this controller will help you to subscribe, to receive some notification. So indirectly, your application could send some SMS, email, or even application message that can be posted later on. So this is really what we can create as an ultimate advanced smart API. So now we cover all the properties that we described together as a smartphone or smartwatch. Now we can perhaps consider and for sure consider our API as a smart entity or smart concept. And it's something that we try to apply for all our API design. And What kind of lesson and secret around this designing smart API is the modularity. Because in fact, when you start to be data-centric and to be oriented object, you have something modular and you can add more things. So basically, the cornerstone is to be resource-oriented for sure. And whatever the way to interact with your system, if you're resource-oriented, even via GraphQL, OpenAPI, AsyncAPI, gRPC, you have to be data-centric or resource-oriented. Then each resource should have a state, and this state will give you a dynamic view of your resource. Autonomous is the fact to attach some job around your resource. And it could be seen as a process, but please do a step back. What is it? In fact, you use the concept of microservice concept to be standalone entity doing simple things around something, which is very having a very usage limited scope. Connected, yes, for sure, with Link, Hypermedia, Hyperschema, we cover the connectivity. Webhook is the fact to receive event, and Async API will be the part to send event. So here we can consider via this modularity where I hope elegant. I hope it was part of my presentation to be elegant in the way to design things, but elegant in the manner to be simple. And you see, I hope everything was obvious for you. You have a path, and to each resource you can attach some entity. And after that, easy to use. But in a minimum of time, we are able to add new features without breaking everything, and we stay stable. This was our major motivation when we try to design something consumed by our API consumer. We have to be we have to be modular in order to provide more and more information, but in the simplest way. So I hope I try to give you another angle of your API, very close to your real life, like a smartphone, smartwatch, to help your designer to design something smart. And at the end, it's smart for everyone, for the consumer and for the producer. So I finish my my talk. So now if you have some questions, I will be happy to answer them.
Thanks, Patrick. So one question. So you did say smart APIs and smartphones and things, but in reality, where is your smart APIs are used in business use cases in production now?
When you say smart API, it's the way to start to smart slowly with a simple object, and the idea is to grow and grow. So basically, all our new APIs since 5 years now are designed like that. So we use this principle for every design. And since 5 years, we are very, I would say, stable. If you use those principles, let's say you are a little bit protected by new concept arriving every week or every month, during every, let's say, sprint. If you are in agile mode, you have to grow and to add new features step by step. And you have to stay stable for your consumer. So yes, we apply this concept systematically. Yep. And new concept could arrive later on, for sure.
Definitely. So it's always a challenge, right? Smart APIs, not crossing the limit and getting into making it in itself into a complex API as well. So there are some controls. Are there any controls and things that you guys have placed?
By experience in API design, each time there is a new format or a new way of presenting. So you started with XML, SOAP XML, RedJSON. Now we have something arriving like GraphQL or gRPC and protocol buffer. Each time you change your format, basically people try to redesign their API and they tell you, I redesigned something to be simple. But the problem, at the beginning, you are always simple, whatever you do. But step by step, you add more functionality and things are growing, growing, growing. And you have no way to control and to say, no, I have to stay simple systematically. And basically, those principles are helping you to grow, but at least your original concept of simple to present things will stay at the beginning. And you let discover by adding some satellite around your product or around your resource, I would say, will help you to show only a part to your user. You can have a simple swagger file to present, let's say, the survival kit of your API. And then if the customer is asking you more functionality, you can have some add-ons. And basically, those add-ons will be presented in the same manner as the original simple concept.
One last question, being data-centric, you meant resourcing the data model in the right way. Are there any data governance tools that you use in your organization?
Mm-hmm. Basically, the maturity of the market is not very high in terms of design, I'd say. You have to use a lot of tools. And basically, historically, when you want to create a data model, people start to think about UML. Okay, but in fact, in the real life, the designer don't want to use that. But we are using Stoplight. I know that one of the presenter, Phil Sturgeon, is presenting something today or tomorrow. I don't remember exactly. So that kind of tool is helping a lot the designer to prepare data models that you can share cross API also. So we are using Stoplight. And also in the design phase, I would say. After that, an API management is useful with an API gateway, API portal. But here I'm speaking really on the life cycle at the beginning of your part, which is a design tool like Stoplight, where you have the designer, the mockup server, and some features to help the governance during the design. But yes, data model is crucial even for GraphQL. If you have nothing to show, so to be data centric, you have to present basically a data catalog. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Patrick. Great to have you here today.
Super. So have a nice day.
Wonderful.